atmospheric pressure in this cavity with the external environment in cavity by chewing gum, moving your jaws repeatedly over and over again, or protracting your jaw. So you can actually cause those pressures to equilibrate. Just like the fusion, pressure goes from high to low pressure. So if you have very high pressure in here, by moving your jaw around certain angles, you can actually equilibrate this pressure with the external environment through your nasal pharynx. So that would be like popping your eardrums when you're driving a mountain to fly. So that eustachian tube connection is important because it allows you to, allows equilibration of middle ear cavity pressure with atmospheric pressure. Because if pressure builds up too much, it can actually prevent those ear ossicles from vibrating very well. And when pressure builds up, you might notice that you hear, you don't hear as well, because those little ear ossicles can't vibrate. Well, that's pretty much all you need to know about the middle ear, right? Because now we get on to the difficult stuff, the actual inner ear. So let's go over to page 4. Inner ear is one of the more confusing anatomical structures. You guys look at the ear lab yet? No? Okay. So basically, the inner ear, this is just going to be a drawing I erase real quick after I draw it, but so you don't really get to draw this down yet, just kind of recognize where I'm at. The inner ear is made up of a little structure called a vestibule, which is a bony little structure filled with a fluid that's similar to cerebrospinal fluid called endolymphs. And off of this vestibule, you have a structure that looks an awful lot like a snail. That we call the cochlea. All right. This is the structure that's important for hearing. And really, if you think it's important for hearing, basically it's within this structure that sound waves into a chemical signal. So getting back to the whole point of talking about the sensory organs that we do, it's within this cochlea that your sound waves are converted into a chemical signal. Now it's a real bad drawing of the cochlea. We'll draw another one here in a second. But the vestibule is also connected to some other structures. Or semicircular canal complex. Talk about your semicircular canal complex probably on Thursday, because we're not going to get to it today. But this these semicircular canals, of which you have three of them, are actually going to be important for your body to interpret its orientation. Semicircular canals are important for perceiving the orientation of your body. And we're going to cover those, like I said, probably Thursday. We'll talk about balance and body orientation. So it's the cochlea we're going to talk about today. Now, in all cases, your stapes actually inserts on a little connective tissue window of the vestibule. And we call this little window the oval window. Right? So the cochlea, the vestibule, and semicircular canals are all very bony. Right? of bones, but they're bony, hard, calcified deposits. But there's little connective tissue windows. And the stapes inserts on one, and we call the little connective tissue window, and it's a lot like the eardrum. It's just a very thin piece of connective tissue. We call it the oval window. It's almost like a window, because if you can actually are good enough to dissect these out, it's slightly translucent because it's such a thin piece of connective tissue. So it's kind of like a window. So we have something called an oval window that stapes actually communicates with on the vestibule. Right? So, sound waves hit the tympanic membrane or the eardrum. They cause it to vibrate, causing the hammer to vibrate, causing the anvil to vibrate, causing the stapes to vibrate, causing the oval window to vibrate. So we've transferred these sound waves from one membrane, the eardrum, to another membrane on the vestibule. Right? And this vestibule, this is made up, this whole thing here is basically your inner ear. So your inner ear is this bony complex, semicircular canals in the cochlea and their vestibule. Right. So to figure out how sound is produced or perceived or transmitted to the primary auditory centers in your temporal regions of your brain, you have to figure out what happens after that little window is vibrated. Now, you can't tell from my great drawing on the board that this is a three-dimensional structure and it's hollow on the inside. So we have a three-dimensional kind of bulbous vestibule. My semicircular canals are slightly three-dimensional on different planes, which is appropriate. But the cochlea itself is also like a three-dimensional snail shell that's hollow on the inside. Okay? So in order to figure out what's going on, we have to kind of look at the inside of our snail. Our little snail inside, all wrapped inside its little shell. The snail's little shell obviously is supposed to represent that bony cochlea. Now, again, we have little tiny windows, the one I've mentioned so far. Even though it's on the vestibule, we'll just draw it on the snail because that makes more sense. On our snail, we have our little oval window. Now, just below the snail, we have another little window that's also kind of roundish in appearance. And someone was really creative with this one, called this one the round window. This is always one of the most confusing things in hearing physiology, is that we have an oval window and a round window. Whatever. So we know that this oval window is connected to the stapes. Now, the snail itself, snails, if you cut them open, these are hollow organisms. They have like an internal cavity. really isn't a snail head in your ear. This would just be a blind ending skull. I mean, don't really think there's snails. But for more fun terminology, around that scala media, that whole internal snail cavity, we have a scala vestibuli and a scala tympanum. Notice that the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani, based on how the snail is organized, they're actually connected, right? If we trace these all around, you can see that there's the little point at which they're connected. Because they're going to connect around that little bend in the tail of the snail. That actually has a funny name. What do we call that? Like the heavy corpus or something, something or other. It's got helicotrema. That's it. This little point where those two chambers come together is called a helicotrema. I don't know if that's really important, but it's one of those terms that you pick up over the years. Now again, these little openings are actually fluid-filled. So they're fluid-filled cavities within this snail. And the fluid inside of them is called something different depending on where it is. Even though the fluid itself is all very similar. In the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani, the fluid inside of it we call parallel. Scala media, fluid inside the scala media we call endolymph. This fluid is going to be very important in terms of sound perception. Because when waves are created, or when waves vibrate your eardrum and get transmitted all the way down to the vocal window, this fluid is going to take on a wave-like pattern. Let's think about that. We have our waves in our ear canal, vibrating the eardrum, vibrating the ear, the hammer, vibrating the anvil, vibrating the stapes, vibrating the oval window, which then takes those vibrations and converts them back into waves. But instead of waves through the air, we now are going to be generating waves in a fluid-filled scala vestibuli chamber of the snail. This fluid that the waves are going to be formed in is called perilymph. Perilymph and endolymph both are pretty similar to cerebral spinal fluid. So kind of like blood plasma with some a little bit different ion concentrations, both out there in the blood cell. So basically, once that oval window starts vibrating due to the vibration of the stapes, it's going to cause waves to be generated in the scala media. Those waves can travel all the way around that cochlea, depending on their frequency. So, draw a little wave. It's a little wave generator. So lower frequency waves travel further in liquid. And high frequency waves, which is important because these low frequency waves are going to get farther